The Pacific Islands Forum is our region's most important diplomatic event, and this year's forum is shaping up as one of the most significant in decades, with China on the rise and climate change threatening some islands' existence. Pacific foreign ministers have been meeting in recent days ahead of the leaders arriving, and One News Pacific correspondent Barbara Dreaver is on the ground in the Fijian capital of Suva. Tēnā koe, Barb, thanks for being with us. Barb, I know there has been speculation this year that the forum as a whole could fall apart. What sense are you getting about the state of relationships between different countries?
Yes, well, the word that I've been hearing the most of from Pacific Island leaders and officials is hopeful that the 18 member countries will be united. But I can tell you for an absolute fact, there is no guarantee of that. And that is going to be a huge problem here at that forum. It's what this Pacific Islands Forum is all about. Of course, what is at stake is power, and when the stability of the region is under threat and regionalism is under threat, then we've got a real problem. We have, of course, Jack, heard from some of the Micronesian countries. There are five of them who threatened to leave. For years they've felt undervalued and sidelined. Now, a deal was stitched together just last month to keep them in the forum, but my understanding is not all of them have signed this agreement, and that's going to be discussed here at this forum.
Why does the forum matter so much?
Well, that's a very good question. It's because as a block of 18 countries, they're so much more powerful together on the international stage than as individuals. So for the individual Pacific countries who might be isolated, it does form an area of protection. But also on the international stage, geopolitically, they have a lot of weight behind them. For example, New Zealand got onto the Security Council in 2015, was voted on by predominantly votes from Pacific neighbours. So we count on the Pacific Forum working as well. Also, there's something called the Blue Pacific Strategy, and this is for the 2050. They want all of the Pacific nations to be as one, to act as one continent. Now, if one of the countries is not part of the forum this year, that will weaken that, and it also weakens this as a geopolitical weight.
Yeah, Barb, how much is China and its growing interests in the region looming over this year's forum?
Well, it's definitely looming. I mean, there's just no getting away from that. While most of the island countries have a very good relationship with China, except for four Pacific countries, when you mention the word security, then you've got a problem. And for a couple of reasons. One is that, of course, there is the fear that the Pacific could become militarized by China. We've already got that Chinese agreement with the Solomon Islands. And so countries like the US, New Zealand, Australia, particularly disturbed by this. And so for Pacific countries, they are worried that they're going to be collateral damage in this geopolitical tussle. Now, so big is the China issue, Jack, I can tell you that the post-forum dialogue, which happens after the formal meetings, and that's between countries like China and the US and Pacific leaders, that's off the table now. It's now not happening.
Right. Okay, from China then to climate change. And how much is the conversation around climate change shifting from prevention to mitigation for those lower-lying Pacific countries?
It's mitigation. It's absolutely about that for most of the Pacific Island countries. Now, you only need to look at Kiribati and Tuvalu. They've had big drought problems. Fresh water has had to be flown into those countries. And when you've got things like that, along with changing weather patterns, more cyclones, what's going to happen with those small island countries is that they will become unlivable before they're swamped with seawater. And that's the issue that many of them are facing now. Tuvalu has come up now looking at the worst case scenario. How can we deal with that? And that's the reality for many of these small island countries.
Right, Barb, a big few days ahead. Love your work. Thank you so much. That is One News Pacific correspondent Barbara Dreaver in Suva. Now, we want to highlight one Pacific nation that Barb just mentioned in particular, the tiny island nation of Tuvalu. For Tuvalu, climate change is very much an existential threat. And Foreign Minister Simon Kofe gained international headlines for delivering a speech to an international climate summit knee-deep in water to symbolise rising sea levels. Tuvalu is also one of the few countries anywhere in the world that still maintains diplomatic relations with Taiwan over China. Yesterday, Barbara Dreaver sat down with Tuvalu Foreign Minister Simon Kofe.
Well, there are a number of issues that are affecting Tuvalu and the Pacific. The geopolitics as well in the region, we understand it's really intensifying. And so I think that we're at a critical time for us to come together. It makes a big difference when you're speaking face to face, and especially when you're discussing very hard issues. How do we position ourselves and respond to the geopolitical competition that's ongoing right now? How do we re-emphasize again the importance of climate change as an issue that should be on the agenda all the time?
Is New Zealand a strong enough climate change partner for Tuvalu?
Well, I think there's always more that can be done. I think that's the message, I guess, I want to put forward to New Zealand, Australia, and some of the bigger countries. Tuvalu and other countries that are low-lying are facing the full brunt of climate change, although we contributed very little to the problem. And so I think it's an issue of justice as well, that some of these bigger countries that are contributing to the problem need to provide the support. You know, there are many projects that they could do with more funding, like building seawalls, protecting our coastal areas, reclaiming land. And that's something that we hear a lot as well with countries like Tuvalu on the international plane, advocating for greater flexibility in finances coming to the to the region.
So more cash and investment from New Zealand wouldn't go amiss.
Exactly, that's right. Tuvalu has been looking into the future in a scenario where we are forced to relocate or our islands are fully submerged. Do we still consider ourselves a state? Can we have the right to vote in some of these international bodies? Do we have claims to our EEZ and the resources in our waters? So we're looking long term, and we want to ensure that we find legal avenues now to be able to secure our statehood under international law. Obviously, this never happened in the history, because we've never had a country disappear because of climate change. So it's a totally new area under international law that Tuvalu is pioneering, and we're hoping that other countries come on board as well to accept this.
How important is regionalism given the global geopolitics that's happening, like countries like China making a big play in the region?
Regionalism is critical. I think maintaining the unity of the Pacific is critical to be able to navigate through the challenges that we see ahead of us. We are only stronger together as we are isolated. But obviously this is not the first time that we've seen outside powers showing interest in the Pacific. In fact, history would tell us that we have some very dark experiences with that. Tuvalu, the island that I live on, about half of our population was taken during the slave trade to work in Peru. Interest in phosphate in the region, nuclear testing. I mean, there are numerous examples of how outside powers have really affected the Pacific. So I think what we really need to do now is look at those experiences and say we don't want to walk down that path again. We need to be smarter than we were many years ago, and to really position ourselves correctly so that we're securing our future and the future of our future generations.
How important is recognising Taiwan for Tuvalu? Because you'd be one of a few countries in the Pacific that do, right?
Yeah, that's correct. So there are only four countries in the Pacific right now that recognise Taiwan. And I think globally there's 14 countries. And so we are in the minority, particularly in the South Pacific. We're the only country right now that recognises Taiwan. So obviously there is always pressure there on us from China and to make that switch. But I think for us it's important that we that we are clear on our position. Taiwan has been a friend of Tuvalu since 1979. I think they're one of the very first diplomatic partners that we had when we became independent. So we value that. Under our culture, we value relationships, genuine relationship and trust. Those are values that are very dear to Tuvaluans. But we are living in a time where those values are being challenged, and it's important that we need to continue to shine the light, I guess.
But why not switch to China? Wouldn't they perhaps give you more?
Yes, well, this brings me to how I think the Pacific should be moving towards. You know, we became independent in 1978, and as much as we appreciate the support from partners to help Tuvalu, I think the nation has to mature to a place where we're not so dependent on outside help, because I think it really defeats the purpose of becoming independent, to put yourself in another position to be dependent on others. And so that's why I feel that the Taiwan-China issue should not be a major issue for Tuvalu, if we're looking at it from that perspective, that we're this is just part of the journey. We want to move towards a position where we are self-sufficient, we're able to support ourselves, and I hope that one day Tuvalu can be a donor and help other countries as well. And so I think that's the attitude that we need to take, as not just for Tuvalu, but I think for the Pacific as a whole. In that way, we are in greater control of what happens in the region and the direction that we want to move towards.